Across this nation, as many as 65,000 dogs and 20,000 cats are currently unlucky enough to be spending their lives not in a home with a loving family, but in a cold, dark lab. Rather than pettings and walks, all these poor animals know is the coldness of the lab and the experiments they suffer far from the light of day. We do this for various causes, some more worthy than others. Nonetheless, after all these animals have been through, we ought to try our best to do right by them when their time as test subjects comes to an end. While we may permit animal testing in this country, it does not go unacknowledged that these animals in the lab are living, sentient beings. For this reason, since 1985, the Federal Animal Welfare Act has imposed restrictions that, at least in theory, are to provide humane treatment safeguards for these lab animals to minimize their suffering. One area where the Animal Welfare Act falls woefully short, however, is in failing to provide any guidelines for these animals' departure from the lab. As a result, standard lab operating procedure has been to euthanize the animals once they are no longer useful. This is where the Beagle Freedom Bill comes in. Named after the beagle, the most common breed of dog used in animal testing due to their docile, loving, and forgiving nature, these state bills vary in specifics but share the core function of requiring labs to institute adoption plans so that their dogs and cats who are still physically and mentally fit to be pets are at least given a chance to find a home. In many ways, this seems to be an obvious and uncontroversial stance, allowing for the consideration of the animals without having to sacrifice research capacity. The traditional rationales for euthanasia continuing to be the standard retirement treatment certainly do not stand up to scrutiny. The fallacious belief that lab animals cannot adapt to life as pets was once widely held, but is fading fast. While for some animals, experimentation might leave them incapable of adapting to normal pet life, most are able to move past their trauma with love and care, becoming well-adjusted members of the family. Research has shown that over 91% of owners of former laboratory dogs would choose another laboratory dog, clearly dispelling the idea that they are incapable of becoming good pets. This change in perception can also be seen in the shift in mindset of federal agencies. The National Institute of Health and the Food and Drug Administration recently recognized lab animals' capacity to become good pets through their implementation of post-lab adoption programs. Another significant reason that organizations might opt for a strict policy of euthanasia is fear of civil liability resulting from adoptions gone wrong. If an organization adopts out a dog that reasonably should have known to have a dangerous temperament, and that dog attacks a person, civil lawsuit could be brought against the organization. Some research organizations that might otherwise be willing to deal with the hassle of adopting out their animals instead either limit their adoption programs to exclusively lab employees or refuse to put a program in place at all to avoid liability issues. Consequently, a staple feature of a Beagle Freedom Bill is a civil liability protection provision, eliminating this issue. Finally, a common justification for mandatory euthanasia policies is simple economic expediency. Short of a governmental subsidization program, it is unlikely that adopting out lab animals will ever be cheaper than disposal. However, both public and private research organizations claim to have effective animal adoption programs, so clearly the costs are not overly prohibitive. Surely then, a mere economic inconvenience is not a sufficient rationale to allow for mass slaughter of these otherwise healthy cats and dogs. In many states, this logic has convinced the state legislators to take action and pass a Beagle Freedom Bill. Despite the first Beagle Bill being signed into law as recently as 2014 in Minnesota, 10 other states have since passed their own similar legislation, and 4 states currently have legislation in the pipeline. While there have been, and currently are, attempts at getting a federal bill through Congress, none have yet to be ratified by either house. Still, as the states continue to pass their own Beagle bills, it seems to simply be a matter of time until there is progress on the federal front. None of this should be particularly surprising, considering the numbers and direction of public opinion on the use of lab animals in research. Polling has shown that today, almost 1 in 2 Americans believe that medical testing on animals for any purpose is morally wrong, and 1 in 3 believe that animals should have the same rights as humans. Further, a substantial 2 out of 3 Americans oppose the use of animals in cosmetics testing. Meanwhile, recent studies on the efficacy of animal testing suggest that the test results are much less useful in terms of applicability to humans than we once thought. Given the love people ubiquitously hold for dogs and cats, the response to saving these animals via legislative success would surely be positive. Still, while elective officials might desire to be solely responsive to public opinion, the reality is that gaining the support of prominent organizations and institutions is needed due to the importance of their endorsements and their campaign financing capabilities. In Illinois, a Beagle bill sponsored by State Senator Linda Holmes saw her and her bill come under fire from fierce opposition led by the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign and some of her fellow Illinois lawmakers as well. In their opposition, the university publicly argued that such a bill was unnecessary and, given their fantastic pre-existing adoption program, a solution in search of a problem. Yet, despite the university's boasting, they were far from transparent when it came to producing records to back up their claims. For instance, the university publicly claimed that it possessed 30 research dogs and euthanized 4 of them between 2011 and 2015, the years prior to the eventual passing of the bill. If this were true, the university's policy of limiting adoption out to the school's staff and students, with the supposed justification of keeping the dogs in a familiar environment, potentially could have been reasonable. However, when proponents of the Beagle bill were able to obtain the U.S. Department of Agriculture's records, they showed that the university had an average of at least 780 research dogs during this period. While hopefully many of these dogs were adopted out, the limitations of potential recipients and lack of trails of ownership means this might just be wishful thinking. In the end, though, the bill passed without resistance from the university, who claimed that they were satisfied and willing to cooperate with the passing of a bill that would simply see them continue with what they've always been doing. Despite the university's claims, the passing of SB 1884 in 2017 forced the institution to alter its adoption program in accordance with the legislation's requirements. Chief among these changes was the expansion of the adoption program through partnership with Homes for Animal Heroes, whose goal it is to find homes for retired research animals. To get to this place of cooperation, compromises were struck in the bill's final language. First, the applicability of the bill was narrowed from applying to all animals down to just dogs and cats. Additionally, rather than imposing an adoption program upon research institutions, they were given the freedom to create and tailor their own, so long as they still complied with the statutory requirements. The fact that these compromises can be made without sacrificing the central purpose of the bill goes to show that getting this legislation passed is a very achievable goal. Ultimately, this Illinois example showcases the risks, but also the great potential and opportunity for lawmakers with introducing or supporting a Beagle Freedom Bill in their own state. From a policy perspective, the bill accomplishes an important end by ensuring that research organizations that do not have adoption programs create them, and that the pre-existing programs meet requirements that prevent them from being merely superficial. From a popularity perspective, prevention of the unnecessary death of cats and dogs is undeniably popular, finding broad support across all of society. When handled properly, it is possible to work with the would-be opposition to pass an uncontroversial and effective Beagle Freedom Bill that can make a legislator the savior of the animals and the champion of the people.